You can pull out your Bibles. You have a little note sheet in there too. Pull that out. Get your pen ready. You'll want to have all those devices handy this morning. We're continuing a series that we've started about 3 weeks ago called Be Rich. And the whole design behind this and thought behind that is that we want you to be as rich as you can be. When you stand before God, that you will have invested your life in such a way that as you stand before Him, there will be richness to your life. That, as we'll see in a passage momentarily, that you will have a firm foundation for the life to come. Now, whenever you talk about being rich in terms of God's perspective, being rich toward God, there's a word that is always attached to it throughout the entire Bible, and that's the word generosity. Generosity and this command to be rich are synonymous terms. You cannot be rich unless you're generous, at least not in God's economy. Because the essence, the heartbeat of generosity is the fulfillment of the two kind of pivotal statements that Jesus made. The great commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Generosity is a summation of those two things. The Great Commission, therefore, go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. The essence of that also is generosity. If you were to boil down the commandment of the Christian life, it would be generous. Because generosity is the play out, the embodiment of love. Generosity is the embodiment of love. You know John 3:16, I'm guessing. For God so loved the world that he gave. And he didn't give stingily. He didn't give you like, oh, I'll give you a little portion off the side. What did he give? He gave himself. He gave his son. And he went to the greatest extent possible to purchase for you your salvation, to bring you into right relationship with him. He went to the cross. Right? That was a very costly purchase. That was a very costly sacrifice. For God so loved the world that he gave. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And as Romans chapter 8 is going to hit us later in the future, it says that if God did not spare his own son for us, why would he not with him also give us all things? The generosity of God is displayed because God loves us. You, in your call to love the world, it's a call to be generous because generosity is the embodiment of love. I want to check out this passage in 1 Timothy chapter 6. I'm shuffling some passages around. Now, this is a statement. Paul is writing to Timothy about how he should instruct those in the church who are rich. And he says, as for the rich in this present age. Now, let me just stop there to bring all of you into that statement. Because you do realize that the average American lives on an average of about $90 a day. 90 bucks a day. Now, if you were to do the math, times that by 30, right, you're about 2,700 bucks a month, which is, we'll say, round up to $3,000 a month, which is probably well below most of your monthly spending habits. I mean, I'm guessing most of you don't live on a $36,000 a year budget, right? But that's the average American experience of spending and living on. Now compare that with the fact that over 1 billion people in the world live on less than a dollar a day. 3 other billion people live on less than $2 a day. So over half the world is 45 times less in their spending and use of stuff in a day than the average American. 45 times. And probably for us in this room, it's a larger amount because you don't live in California very well on a $36,000 income, right? The vast majority of you probably have more than that. So you and I, when we think about who the rich are in this present age, he doesn't say to the rich who are in Corinth, to the rich who are in Ephesus, as if, now let's take your economy and now let's make it into a compared size. It's the rich in this present age. Those of you, and Americans, Christians, we're rich, right? Now, let me just say something really quickly. I'll throw these stats out sometimes here and there, and this is never my intent. My intent is never, ever to cause you to feel guilty or shame. It's not to cause you to feel any kind of guilt like, oh man, woe is me, I'm a rich person. You know, that's terrible news. That's not the goal. But it is to help us realize the direction of the calls in the scripture, and also to realize the opportunity that is given to us in the process. Because we want to always take advantage of noticing the opportunities God has given to us to maximize that, because we want to, as the title implies, be rich toward God, right? That's our goal. And being rich toward God is attached to being generous. So, Paul says, as for the rich in this present age, charge them not to think highly of themselves, nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of their riches, but on God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. Now, he goes on to kind of describing what this kind of life might look like. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous. Again, to be rich is to be generous and ready to share. Thus, storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation.